Hi everyone, welcome back. It's time for another BookTube prize round video. This is for the nonfiction semifinals. If you stumbled across this video and you don't know what on earth I'm talking about, I will link a video down below that explains what the BookTube prize is and why I'm making a semifinals video about it. For this nonfiction semifinals, I got assigned group A, which I was actually very happy about. Of the two possibilities that I could have gotten, this was my preferred group because there were multiple books in that group that I already had on my want to read list, so very happy to have a reason to actually read them over the next 2 months. So this will just be my little intro, some initial thoughts on the 6 books that I've been assigned, and then of course there will be timestamps down below where you can jump to my more finalized thoughts as I finish the books throughout June and July. And of course, I'll do a final ranking wrap up at the end. The first book in my group is The Dragons, The Giant, The Women, which is a memoir by Wayétu. And it talks about escaping the first Liberian Civil War with her family and building a new life in the United States. I had not heard about this book before it came up for the BookTube prize, but obviously if it's gotten to the semifinals, it's holding its own against some stiff competition, so I'm looking forward to reading this one. The second book is Notes on a Silencing, which is a memoir by Lacy Crawford, and I already have this one from the library because this was a book that I was actually interested in reading before it was assigned to me. This memoir talks about a sexual assault that Lacy experienced when she was 15. She was attending a prep school, boarding school in Concord, New Hampshire, and she was sexually assaulted by 2 18-year-old students. When the sexual assault happened, it was buried, and then it only comes back to light a number of years later when Lacey's contacted by the local police department, I guess because some other sexual assault victims had come forward. That prompted her to take a look back at what happened to her when she was 15. And I am already over 100 pages into this book. I've been reading it for 2 days now, and I'm really enjoying it, so that is boding very well for a hopefully high score once I'm actually finished. Third is Our Bodies, Their Battlefields, War Through the Lives of Women by Christina Lamb. This is another one that I was already interested in reading before it got assigned to me. This is, from what I understand, a very difficult read. It takes a look at how war affects women. A lot of the time, the stories that we hear are about men on the battlefields and them killing each other. However, women also suffer greatly during wartime, and a lot of that has to do with rape and how it's used as a weapon against women. So that's what this book is delving into. The book is written by one of Britain's leading foreign correspondents, so I have high hopes for this one. The fourth book is one I've already read. It's The Address Book, What Street Addresses Reveal About Identity, Race, Wealth, and Power by Deirdre Mask. I read this for the Octafinals back earlier this year, and I really enjoyed this book. I gave it 4 stars. I thought it did a really interesting dive into a lot of aspects of why addresses are important, why they exist, what happens when you don't have one, and just looking at how different countries around the world address the idea of addresses. Definitely recommend, and it'll be interesting to see how it holds up amongst all of these fresh competitors. Number 5 is The Dead Are Arising, The Life of Malcolm X, which is written by Les Payne and Tamara Payne. This is a super detailed look at the life of Malcolm X. Les Payne actually began researching this book in the 1990s, and then he actually passed away in 2018, so his daughter Tamara helped finish off the book and get it published. This is a big book. It's over 600 pages. The audiobook, which I have from the library, is over 18 hours long. And the reason it's so big is because it's gonna get into a lot of details. Les Payne interviewed a ton of people, so he's just compiling massive amounts of information to help us understand not only Malcolm's life, but kind of the context of what was happening around him. The final book that I have to read that I'm very excited about, because I actually got this book for Christmas, so it was already on my own TBR, and that is Caste, The Origins of Our Discontents by Isabel Wilkerson. This book explores the idea of a hidden caste system in America by comparing it to other systems in the world, and I am very, very excited to finally read this book. I have heard nothing but amazing things, so my expectations are definitely high, but I feel like it's going to meet them. Those are the 6 books I've been assigned, 5 of which I still need to read, so as I finish them off, I will check back in with you onward to my first completed book.
I finished my first book, and unsurprisingly, it's Notes on a Silencing by Lacy Crawford. This book was fantastic. I experienced the entire range of emotions while reading this. There were scenes where I was incredibly uncomfortable reading them, specifically when she gets into details about what happened to her and her sexual assault and sort of the health ramifications of that. There were times where I was incredibly frustrated. I would actually say I was frustrated through a lot of this book, not because of the writing or anything with the book itself, but just the aggravation of her being sexually assaulted by 2 18-year-old students on campus when she was 15, so she's a minor, and the school finding out about it eventually and burying it because they don't want their reputation to be ruined. So that is incredibly frustrating, this institution going up against a 15-year-old girl. I mean, it's a story that exists in many forms and has for many years before this story takes place in the early 90s and many years after. There were also moments of happiness, though, when she was extended a kindness or when she was talking about spending time with her friends or a particular boyfriend that she had. So there were those really sweet moments too. And this is the kind of book where I would sit down and I wouldn't really be able to stop reading, even though it was incredibly frustrating at times. I really liked the writing style, and I found that the way she told the story to keep me engaged and to the point where I was reading this book and I was reading like 50, 60 pages at a time without checking my phone or doing anything else, which I think is rare for me these days, for me to actually read that many pages without interruption. I was looking at Goodreads after just to kind of see what other people were saying because my experience was really positive and my bad things, negative things about the book, they're very minor. And I was just curious what other people thought. And I was actually surprised by the number of people that gave it 1 star because they found that the book spent too much time focusing on other things that weren't really relevant to the sexual assault storyline, and because that is definitely how it's sold, as a book that's going to focus on that and what happened with the school and where things are now. She does spend a lot of time giving background about her family and her other years at school before and after she was sexually assaulted, so there's a lot of other stuff that is covered in detail, and to be fair, there were a few times where I felt like that detail was a bit much and she could have left a certain thing that she kind of went off on a tangent about. She could have left that out, but I found that most of the time, especially when it was stuff with the school and her friends there and the classes and whatnot, I thought that was important because it gave the reader an idea of what her experience was like. I enjoyed those parts, and you may or may not like that kind of thing. If you are okay with getting a lot of extra detail, a lot of background info, definitely still read this book. If that's not really what you're looking for and you're looking for kind of a sole focus on the sexual assault aspect of the story, maybe this one won't be for you. But I had really no problem with it other than a few times where I felt like she could have left some stuff out because it was just like a little too much detail that I didn't think was really helpful in giving the context of the overall story. The author had already established herself as somebody who was interested in literature and writing and everything before she wrote this book, so she definitely has a talent. I think some people might think her writing is a bit overblown and pretentious at times. I did not have that problem. There was some really nice moments though where I felt she articulated something very well, and there was one particular little paragraph that I just wanted to read now because it's after she's been sexually assaulted, and it's one of those things where it's a very private, scary thing to happen, but because the boys at the school kind of bragged about any sexual conquest that they had, naturally, the entire school knows. So Lacy is obviously feeling like she deserves some of this hatred and like this punishment that she feels she's getting for what she did, even though it absolutely was not her fault in any way. But then eventually she starts having these other girls come to her who have been through things, kind of looking to her for advice and guidance. And at one point she says, "I learned that while the fallen woman may keep her unloved door plain and her drapes drawn, her circle small and her fire low, if she's wise, I suppose she will, the path to her back stoop will be well traveled. I guarantee it." And I thought that was such a perfect way to sort of literarily explain what was happening to her with girls coming to knock on her dorm room and just asking for advice and guidance on things because they know that Lacy can help them because she has been through these things. So although it's not anything that you would consider a positive in the sense that you would never want that to happen to somebody, it was nice that girls felt comfortable coming to her and she was willing to help them. So yes, that gives you a bit of a taste of what to expect if you decide to pick up this book. Because it's mid-June, I still have over a month to kind of see how this book sits with me, see if I want to bump it up to 5-star when the time comes, and for the time being, I'll just keep on reading.
Hello, I just finished the second book that I need to read for this round, and it is The Dragons, The Giant, The Women, which is a memoir by Wayétu. This one was unfortunately not quite as good as I wanted it to be, and for me, it comes down to the structure of the book. Before I get into that, I'll at least talk about some of the stuff I did like. So this is a memoir that mostly focuses on Wayétu being 5 years old when civil war breaks out in Liberia. At the time, her mother is in the U.S. studying on a Fulbright scholarship, so it's her father, her sisters, her grandparents, and kind of extended family members that are in Liberia, and they have to escape before the rebels can get a hold of them and potentially kill them. So the first third of the book follows that, and it's written from 5-year-old's perspective. Like, the writing is still very kind of lyrical and poetic. It's quite nice, but the way that Wayétu is interpreting things, it's got like that 5-year-old spin on it. She thinks of this bad guy as sort of like a dragon, and when she's hearing gunshots, she thinks they're drums, and sort of, and her father and the other adults that are with her kind of let her believe this just to keep her from being too scared. So in a way, it was interesting to read that because your mind had to work a little bit extra to sort of understand what was actually happening because she was interpreting things as a 5-year-old, and Wayétu doesn't really explain as from an adult perspective, like, oh, this is what I thought it was when I was 5, but here's what's actually happening. It's like, no, you have to just read a tiny bit deeper to understand what her 5-year-old self was actually seeing. And at first I was kind of like, meh, but I actually ended up really liking that aspect of the story. I enjoyed having to read that part and kind of work a little bit harder to understand everything that was happening, but there was some really powerful moments in there. Then the book shifts to a different section, and it starts talking about kind of coming to America, growing up in Texas, a bit about her family and sort of the adjustment there. She talks about potential boyfriends and all this stuff. And yes, that is something that you can include in a memoir, but I felt like based on that whole first third that I read, it just didn't fit. And then what really threw me off was after that section, there was another section, and it's another thing that goes back to the Liberian Civil War, but it's from her mother's perspective, but it's written in first person. So I was very confused for about a page. I was like, wait, what's happening here? Like, I picked up on it pretty fast overall, but there was just no explanation for the fact that, like, this is a memoir, so you assume everything is going to be from the author's perspective, but this whole last third or so was what her mom was experiencing when she was in New York City and she was trying to find out what had happened to her family. Thing is, I really enjoyed that section too. It just was a bit odd to have it be written from first person. So if I could take that first part and that last part and sort of combine it into something and maybe put a bit more about life in Liberia, or maybe have those two sections next to each other and then have a last section that is about coming to America, kind of where she is now. I mean, this author is still quite young, so she has a lot of life left to live, so there's certainly not going to be some big grand conclusion when it comes to those things. But yeah, I just found that the fact that there was this whole middle section that was focusing on, you know, life in Texas and coming to America and boyfriends and whatnot, and actually a little bit about going back to Liberia as an adult, that just felt very odd in the flow. I didn't like how the sections fit together, but I did like aspects of each of the sections, particularly the first and the last one. It's a good book, but it's not a great book. It's definitely in the middle bottom of the pack right now for what I have read, so we'll see where it ends up overall. At the moment, I am about 60% of the way through the Malcolm X book, and let me tell you guys, it's a struggle. It's a bit of a struggle. Thank goodness I decided to listen to that on audiobook so I can do other things at the same time, but man, that author did his research, I'll give him that, but it's a lot for me. I have two more books to go, both of which I'm really looking forward to reading, so hopefully the positive vibes and the momentum from how much I'm hopefully like those will help me finish off the Malcolm X book as well. Well, it took me a month and a half, but I finally finished the audiobook of The Dead Are Rising, The Life of Malcolm X by Les Payne and Tamara Payne. This book took me so long to read because it was boring. There was way too much information in here. The author, Les Payne, spent 30 years researching this book, and he passed away before it was published, so his daughter, Tamara, was the one who finalized it and actually got it to be published. And I can understand why it took 30 years to write this and research this book, because there's so much in it, and there's a huge chunk of it that just is not really relevant to the life of Malcolm X. In the audiobook, we were over 2 hours in and Malcolm was 18 months old. There's not much to say about someone who's 18 months old at that point. That 2+ hour span was talking about his parents and what his parents believed in and what organizations his parents were a part of, and also talking about Frederick Douglass and other historical aspects of the United States, which okay, maybe are tangentially related to Malcolm X, but you don't need to spend that much time on it. There was a 45-minute section all about the founding of the Nation of Islam, which, to be fair, the Nation of Islam is very relevant to Malcolm X's life and the story of his life, but we don't need 45 minutes solely dedicated to the players that were part of the founding of that religion. So that was the first thing that irked me, and the first change I would make would be to cut down on all of this extra information that is only tangentially related and is maybe helping to give you a bigger picture, but it's not necessary to the point that the author wrote it. He did not need to be that in-depth. The second thing that really could be changed was the repetitiveness of the descriptors of people. I didn't need to be told 10 times in such a short span of pages who the eldest sibling was in Malcolm's family. I didn't need to be reminded at the very end of the book who Malcolm's wife was. I know we've been talking about her for chapters, or at least her being mentioned. I don't need to be reminded. I don't need you to use the same descriptors for Malcolm over and over again in such a short period of time. So that would be my second thing, is to cut down on all of that, because it really grated me after a while. I mean, when you're already struggling with a book and the author is doing little things that annoy you, they start to drive you kind of crazy. I also felt like this book focused in on certain things that were not that interesting, or at least spent way too much time on certain things, like the entire section about the build-up to Malcolm's assassination and what happened afterward. There was so much information on the movement of people and who kind of suspected what was happening and who was there the moment it happened and who was helping Malcolm, and the FBI agent, the undercover FBI agents, the undercover cops, the actual people who were involved in killing him, and kind of what happened afterward. There was so much information spent on that, and he didn't even talk about really how the family reacted to it until the epilogue. There was so much focus on Malcolm as this figurehead, this person who was traveling to different African countries and and meeting with important people and how he was really growing, especially after he broke away from the Nation of Islam and how that led to his assassination. Those things are obviously interesting to a point, but I feel like we could have backed away from that and spent more time in the later parts of the book reflecting on his relationship with his family, with his siblings and his children and his wife. I mean, it was really a lack of it. Considering how much there was of it at the beginning of the book with his family, it felt odd to not have really any of that in the latter half. There was at least one thing that I found interesting about the book, and that was the comparisons that the author made to the information and the research that he had done and what he had found and what was in Malcolm X's autobiography. He would say how in the autobiography, maybe this one person who Malcolm presented was actually an amalgamation of a few people, or kind of how he maybe didn't mention things or just kind of glazed over things, and how those things were actually kind of interesting, but maybe not something that you want to share when you're, you know, supposed to live this full life and you're still very involved and very well known throughout the world. All that being said, really didn't like this book. And it's unfortunate because I was interested in learning more things about Malcolm X, but this was way more than I wanted. Luckily, the last two books that I need to read, I'm much more excited about. I am probably about a third through Our Bodies, Their Battlefields, and that is a dark book. Very dark, very uncomfortable, but it's good. It's talking about what it's supposed to, and it's very engaging. And then I have to start Caste, which is the last one of the books, and I'm really excited for that one. So hopefully those two will kind of cleanse my palate a bit before the end of all of this. I've now finished my second to last book, and that is Our Bodies, Their Battlefields, War Through the Lives of Women by Christina Lamb. This is probably the darkest book I have ever read. There is so much in this book that will make you incredibly uncomfortable. Every woman that she interviews, you feel like the situation can't get any worse. How can this story top the last one in terms of what humans are capable of during wartime? But yeah, every time it gets a little bit worse, and it can take you a bit to get through this book because you read a chapter or two and it's just, it gets to you. The author travels to a number of different countries to talk to women from all over the world, and there are maps at the beginning of the book to give you an idea of who she's going to talk to. In some cases, she's talking to the women while they're living in these countries. In other cases, she's speaking to them as refugees when they're living elsewhere. So she talks about conflicts in Argentina, Syria, Iraq, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Democratic Republic of the Congo, and then Bangladesh, and it says Burma on this map, but Myanmar. So you cover a lot of ground in this, and that also means that you just get the worst of the worst of stories. She does actually go to the Philippines as well to talk to women who were deemed comfort women by the Japanese army. Obviously, that is not the best term for what happened to them, that she talks to people who were alive during World War II and what they went through, all the way up to stuff that is currently happening now in Syria and so on. The Democratic Republic of Congo is also a very modern story, and the atrocities that these women have faced, it is just, oh, it's so uncomfortable. And on the one hand, you don't want to read about it because it's just so awful, but on the other hand, you do want to know what's going on. And I think this is one of those books where rating it 4 or 5 stars feels weird because it is so intense and it covers such horrible topics, but it's also important for people to know about this book because these things are happening now and we can't hide them. We have to learn from them, or we have to know how we can potentially help to stop them. You hope that there's a bit of a silver lining at the end of this book, but there really isn't that much of that. There's some things that she shares about progress that has been made, or people who are really stepping up to do good things for those who have suffered. But at the same time, a lot of these conflicts are still happening on some level, or the mostly men who perpetrated these acts or were complicit in these acts, they're still walking on the street. Some of them have gone to prison. Some of them have died. But so many of the men who did this to women, and sometimes other men, are free because they've escaped or because the system has decided to just sort of do a blanket forgiveness. So these women will be walking down the street and they can see people who have done this to them. And that must be so, so hard to have to live with that and know that every day. Never mind what's happened to your body and your mind, but also having to see the person who did this to you walking on the street, just, ugh. It feels a little bit weird to say this, but something that I liked about the book was that it did expand my knowledge on things. I had a fair amount of knowledge about some of the stuff that was happening in here, but there were other situations where I didn't know really anything. And so I appreciated being taught about these things and learning what had happened or what is currently happening, just so you can be more aware as a citizen of the world. One thing that I found a bit difficult about this book, besides the actual content of it, was oftentimes she was interviewing these women and she was being told their stories through a translator because she doesn't speak all the different languages. She would take what the women were saying and keep it in their own words as the translator told it to her and put it into the book. And oftentimes it was a bit choppy. It's a little hard to understand just because of that language barrier and how things were translated into English. And they understand the full context of what happened to them. But as a reader, we don't know. And so if we're being told it and it's a little choppy and a little difficult to follow, I sometimes had a hard time getting through that particular, you know, few pages or small chapter because I was just struggling to really understand everything that was happening. Christina does give a lot of background information as to how these conflicts came to be, how these women came to be suffering as much as they did, but still, in terms of individual stories, that could be a little confusing at times. Still, that definitely did not take away from the overall experience of this book. Not a positive one, but a necessary one. If you have the willpower and the stomach to read this book, I would absolutely tell you to do so. Just know that it's going to be really hard and you'll probably have to take some mental breaks because of everything that you read in here. That is the second to last book done. I am a good chunk of the way through Caste. That'll be my last book that I need to get through. So once I finish that, I will come back and give you all my final rankings. All right, I finished my last book for this round, Caste by Isabel Wilkerson. And I must say, I really enjoyed reading this book. I think it's fantastic. And it feels so nice to say that because my expectations were definitely a bit higher for this because of everything that I had seen from other BookTubers and just, you know, from the general population. Everybody seemed to really like this book. And yeah, I'm in that boat too. This looks at the American system as a caste with white people at the top and African Americans at the bottom, and then other races kind of falling in different places within there. And then she compares it to the Indian caste system and then also the system that existed for 12 years under the Nazi government in Germany. There are obviously plenty of differences between each of them, but there's a lot of similarities as well. And I think this is one of those things where you kind of understand what's happening, but this book kind of just tweaks it a little bit and introduces these new ideas to you that you hadn't really thought of before or that you hadn't looked at it from that particular angle. And once you do that, it just makes sense. It's like, why didn't I see this before? Why aren't more people talking about this? She's not the first person to talk about caste in America. There are plenty of academics that came before her that wrote papers on it, that studied it, and she references many of them in here. But I feel like those were more written for an academic point of view, or they are written so long ago that they've just gotten lost in over time. Whereas this is a brand new book, and I really think it's written in an approachable way. It's a bit bigger, but there is about 80 to 90 pages of notes and bibliography at the end. So it's just under 400 pages. And she covers a lot of ground in here, but it's so well written. It's so approachable. She does a great job of talking about the kind of overarching things, maybe using terms that are a little bit harder to understand, but then she takes what she's talked about and she's provided a story, and a personal story sometimes, or a story from someone else that really illustrates what she's trying to say. And I really liked that because obviously I want to understand the raw idea of it, but your brain is going to remember it a lot more easily if there's an example, if there's a story to hold on to in your mind. The book does have a pretty dark tone because it's talking about some dark stuff, but she does end it on a bit of a positive note, kind of talking about where we go from here and what we can do to make things better. She does a great job of breaking down what she calls the 8 pillars of caste, explaining those, comparing it to the Indian caste system, and also kind of what things looked like in Nazi Germany, as I mentioned. And I just thought it came together so well. As I was reading it, I wanted to tell people about what I was reading and recommend it to others. I wouldn't say read this book if you've never read nonfiction before, but if you're someone that is comfortable reading nonfiction, you should absolutely pick up this book because the content in it is fascinating. So now that I've gushed about that book a bit, you have some idea of where it's probably going to fall on my rankings, but we'll start at number 6 and work our way up so you can find out which one's number 1. I'm just going to grab my little list here so I don't make a mistake. If you've watched this video all the way through, my number 6, the lowest spot, it's going to be pretty obvious to you, and that is The Dead Are Rising. Did not have a good time with this book. Way too long, too boring, too much in it. Great for certain people, but for me, it was not good, and it really slowed down my reading for this semifinals round overall. I really had to push to finish Caste in time because I just got so behind because I just did not want to listen to that audiobook. So, you know, part of it's my fault a little bit in terms of my time management there, but the reason is because this book was just so hard to get to. It really took away the motivation and the excitement for a little bit anyway. In the number 5 spot, second from the bottom, I decided to put The Dragons, The Giant, The Women. This one is definitely a step up from The Dead Are Rising. There's a fair bit of distance between 5 and 6 on this list. And although this one had some really interesting parts, I thought the structure was kind of odd, and I think there was a lot of room for improvement in terms of what I was looking for in the book and what I thought was going to be told and how it was told. So for that reason, it's better, but not that good compared to everything else. Number 4, I put The Address Book. It's a little harder to compare just because I read it a few months ago for the Octafinals round, so it's not as fresh in my mind, but it still did very well in my ranking there, and I remember kind of how I felt, and I definitely remember the things that it talked about as I was reading it, and I think it definitely touched on some really cool things, but the overall tone of the book was much more lighthearted and kind of about sharing interesting facts and whatnot. And I'm definitely more of a hard-hitting nonfiction kind of person. I can certainly enjoy a book like The Address Book, where there's a bit more humor mixed in there, and she does a really good job of covering a lot of different places around the world. But when I compare it with the top 3, it doesn't quite make it for me. I want that hard-hitting stuff. In the 3rd spot, I decided to put Our Bodies, Their Battlefields. This one was, as I said, so dark and such a hard read. You have that one side of it where you just feel uncomfortable and it feels weird to talk positively about it. But on the other hand, it's crucial for people to realize what has happened and what is currently still happening, what we can learn from it, how we can do better, how we can help. And so this book had such a grand scale. There was so much covered in it. I really liked it, but there was just some things that it didn't quite get up to that 2nd or 1st spot for me. I would not recommend for everyone, but I absolutely appreciated the fact that it was assigned to me in this. I was already interested in reading it, so to be able to read through it and just absorb everything that that book talked about, it's one of those things that you carry with you, that this book definitely sticks with you. For my 2nd and 1st spot, Notes on a Silencing, I read as my first book for this, and then I finished it up with Caste. So I really had a good bookend, I guess, of reading experiences with them being number two and number one. I decided to put Notes on a Silencing in the second spot. I really connected with this story in the sense that I enjoyed reading everything that she put in there. I know some people said that it kind of wandered a bit and there was too much background info, but I really liked getting that background info and understanding what it was like to live at a boarding school in the US because I've never experienced that. Getting the dynamics of her friends, her classes, her teachers, just the whole environment around her. And then obviously how frustrating it was, her situation. You get so angry reading that book, but it just really stuck with me. And once again, it was another book that I was recommending to people to read. That's why it falls in the second spot here in the number two ranking, because it was such a good reading experience for me, but sometimes it was a little too much. And so for that reason, I decided to put Caste at number one, because this book really taught me a lot. And like I said, it just takes something that you see and just twists it a little bit, or kind of like parts the curtains a little bit more, and you can see it from that different angle, and you think, whoa, this makes so much sense. And this book, I really wanted to tell people about. I wanted to tell them what I was learning. I wanted to recommend it. I wanted to read them passages from it. And so because there was just that little extra bit of wanting to share everything about it because I was so excited about it and I was enjoying my reading experience with it so much, that's why it's number one. I also think it's just a really important book and it's super relevant to what is happening right now. Not that some of these other books aren't, but I think this is one that everybody should read. I know not everybody's going to because nonfiction isn't their thing, but it's one of those books that I think everyone should read because it'll make you a better person, it'll make you more aware of what's happening around you. Even if you think you understand everything about where we are, this book gives you new points of view, new examples, new connections that really just furthered the reading experience. I realized I was not holding this book up the entire time I was talking about it, but yes, Caste. Read it. Please read it. I really hope it moves on in this group. I have a good feeling that it will, but when I'm filming this, the official announcement has not happened. I have submitted my rankings, but the official announcement video has not come out, so I don't know how everything's gonna play out. Hopefully my top three move on, but I'm about half and half for how that works out for me, but I really hope this one moves on to the finals. If you have read any of these books, whether for the BookTube prize or just on your own, let me know what you thought of them down below. If you agree with me or disagree with me, I'd love to hear your opinions. As always, all of our links are in the down bar. You can go check those out if you feel so inclined. Thank you guys very much for watching, and I'll see you later.